Hello. So today I'm here to introduce the first symphonic component ever with a nice logo of its own. Okay. I'm Kevin Dinglas. As you can see, I have a terrible English accent. I come from the north of France. The thing is, even when I speak French, people from other areas of France cannot understand me. Because in the north of France, we have even a terrible French accent. So I am a member of the Symphonic Core team, and I'm also the creator of a very nice framework built on top of Symphonic called API Platform, and we will not speak a single other time of API platform in this talk. So I work at letyield.coop. Okay, so it's a French company, but that is still hiring looking for some people in London. So if you want to learn French and if you want the beautiful accent from the north, you can drop me a mail and we can chat together. It's a company that it's a bit special because it's a worker cooperative. It means that the company belongs to all the employees and only to the employees. And all the benefits we make are shared equally between all the employees at the end of the year. And all the decisions we take are taken in a democratic fashion. So with Symfony 4, it's super easy to get started and to create CRUD applications, CRUD projects, and tiny applications. So to illustrate what's the goal of Panther and how it works, I will start by generate the typical application for a presentation or for a blog post, a blog. And to do that, I will use this skeleton. So who has already used this skeleton in an actual project? Okay, so almost nobody. Actually, it's not a well-known one, but Symfony Skeleton and Symfony 4 is awesome because you get only what you cherry pick. And by default, it's super minimal. It's intended to create APIs and command line application and small apps. But on the other hand, it's super minimal. And if you want to build a traditional website with a database, with a template engine, with the Symfony mailer component and everything you need, it can be a bit tedious to cherry pick what you need to bootstrap the project. So you have an alternative. It's called the Symfony website skeleton, and it contains basically the same things that used to be in the Symfony 3 standard edition. Okay, so let's install this skeleton. And then, because it's a presentation and it must look a bit nice, I've enabled the Bootstrap CSS framework integration. To do so, I just have to add this line to a configuration file and to grab the CSS and JavaScript files using Symfony Encore or Yarn or NPM or anything else. Then I will not have to write a single line of code to get my tiny prototype of blog. To do that, I can use the Maker bundle that has been introduced in Symfony 4 by Ryan Raver. So when I've installed the Symfony website skeleton, I got the Maker bundle and some nice entities like this one to create a Doctrine entity. So it's an interactive command, and I can just specify the name of the entity I want to create, the name of the fields and the types of the Doctrine fields I want to generate, and the tool will automatically generate the PHP class, the properties, the getters, the setters, and the Doctrine mapping that corresponding to that. Then, with the website skeleton, the Doctrine ORM is pre-installed. So the Doctrine migration bundle, so I can run two more commands, make migration, then execute the migration, to populate my database schema to create the database tables that I have to use. Finally, when the migrations are executed, I can use another command, make CRUD, that will generate twig templates and a form type corresponding to the Doctrine entity I've generated earlier. So just by doing so, I get this. A nice tiny application with fully generated code that I will have to edit to tweak for this entity. So I get a list, an edition form, a delete button, and a show view. Okay, so it's a minimal web application. It's easy to get started, and it's the old way of doing web applications. So in API platform, we have some similar generators, but they create Vue.js or React skeletons, and they use the API to fetch the data and update the data. This generator just generates plain old the server-side HTML generated. So okay, it was easy to create the app. I will have to tweak my tiny blog. And as I'm a developer following the best practices, and as I don't want to ship bugs in production, I will have to add tests to my application. Here is a schema coming from the Martin Fowler website explaining the state of the art regarding testing. So in your application, you shouldn't choose between unit test, integration test, and end-to-end test. You must have all of them, okay? So your business logic, your classes, your domain layer must be fully tested using unit test. And in PHP and in Symfony, it's the same tool that is used. It's PHP unit. It comes pre-installed with Symfony, and it's the reference tools to do that. Then you will have to create integration test because you need tests make sure that your classes standalone are tested and behaves properly. But you need to be sure that when you put your classes together to create a website, when you send a proper HTTP request, you will get the proper HTTP response. So then, on the second layer of the pyramid, it's to add some integration tests. You don't have to retest again what is tested by unit test. Okay, it's why it's a pyramid. And then, in your application, you will probably have a web application that will be used through a web browser. You will probably integrate with external services like, I don't know, the Algolia search engine. You will probably use some lines of React or Vue.js to add the nice interaction in your application. You will send mails, and you will have to check that everything, all the pieces are working well together on at least a few critical scenarios. And it's the top of the pyramid. It's end-to-end testing. So in Symfony, you have tools for all these kind of tests. You have PHP unit for unit test, browser kit that I will introduce just after for integration testing, and we used to rely on browser kit for end-to-end testing with Symfony 2, but now we have a new tool to do that, Panther. It's a very important slide, probably the most important slide of the talk, because you must not use Panther as your only testing solution. In your project, you must have both classes of test. So in Symfony, since the release of Symfony 2.0, there is three components to emulate a web browser. Those three components are the browser kit component. It's the top-level component, and it provides a nice PHP API to write web browsing scenarios, and it basically emulates in pure PHP a web browser without user interface. So you can create scenarios like I want to go on this page, then fill this form, then submit the form, then assert that something is displayed on the web page. You have two other components that are integrated in BrowserKit. Actually, BrowserKit uses these components. There is the DOM crawler component, and it allows to crawl and assert on a DOM tree, and basically on XML or HTML documents. And then there is the CSS selector component. So it's a CSS selection engine, and basically it is a jQuery-like API written in PHP. There is also another interesting tool in the ecosystem. It's not part of the Symfony project directly, but it has been written by Fabien Potencier too, as the three other components. It's called Goot. And Goot is a library to do some web scraping. So it means that if you want to extract some data from an external website, if you want to fetch, monitor the prices of your partners or the prices of your own website, externally, you can use Goot to do that. And what is nice with Goot is that it is built on top of these three components, but it uses Guzzle as a HTTP client to do the HTTP request. So it's the same, exact same API than when you use BrowserKit directly. So let's create the first functional test using BrowserKit in Symfony for our tiny blog. To do so, you can use another maker bundle command to generate a test skeleton called make functional test. So let's generate a test and let's fill it. So how it works here is already a BrowserKit web test case user. Nobody use this? Okay. So how do you test your applications in Symfony currently? It's something we need to talk about after. Then, it's super easy to use. This is a PHP unit test case extended by some Symfony specific logic that allows to boot the Symfony kernel. You call a static method and you will get an instance of the BrowserKit component. Actually, there is no HTTP request occurring when doing this functional test. What web test case will do is creating and instantiating an instance of the HTTP foundation request instance. Okay. So it's pure PHP. It will take this object, pass it to the HTTP kernel, let your custom logic execute. Then the HTTP kernel will return an HTTP foundation's response instance. And you will be able, with some helpers provided by this class, to assert on this response and to use the BrowserKit component to crawl your website and to assert that something has been generated in the HTML that to fill some inputs in the form to create the post request corresponding to the form that has been sent and things like that. So, here we get the BrowserKit instance. We enable, we allow to follow redirection, HTTP redirection, because the form will redirect after the submission. We tell BrowserKit to load this URL. There is no HTTP request under the hood. It's only pure PHP and it's fast. Then you can assert on the resulting HTML sent by the server that you want to find the link HTML element with this value and click on it. Then you will go on another page. So there will be another call to the handle method of the Symfony HTTP kernel. On the next page, you want to find the form with a save button. So we are testing the tiny blog, remember. This form, we want to fill it with these values. So we fill the title input with a test post, and we fill the body input with some lower minimum test. And then we submit this form. So this time there is a post request that will be done by calling the handle method of the HTTP kernel of the HTTP kernel Symfony component. Then we will have a HTTP redirection, and we will be redirected on the list because it's how it works with the Symfony controller that has been generated by Maker Bundle. On this list, we want to be sure, we want to assert using PHP unit assertions that the new blog post that we created has been saved and is displayed in the HTML page that we are getting. Okay, so this is a plain old functional test in PHP, and it's what you should already do for your integration test in your PHP and Symfony application. It can work with Symfony. Actually, the underlying components can also be used in any PHP project, any framework, or no framework at all. To execute it, we just have to run PHP unit. So we use the tool PHP unit, but this is not a unit test. It's a bit confusing, but the tool allows to run all kinds of tests. So kernel test case is provided by Symfony. It belongs in the framework bundle. It extends the test case of PHP Unit. So everything that is supported by PHP Unit is also supported by web test case of Symfony. It adds some extra capabilities. And it's not a true HTTP client. It just internally, it's just pure PHP, and it boots and calls the Symfony application by using directly its HTTP kernel. It is built on top of the browser kit, drum crawler, and CSS selector components. And it deals directly with the Symfony primitives, the request, and the response. So it was easy, isn't it, to write this web testing, this functional test by using this elegant API. It's developer friendly and it's fast. As you can see on the previous run, it's some milliseconds to execute the whole scenario on several web pages. It's nice, but it still has some drawbacks. The first one is, what if something bad happens visually? For instance, if your front-end developers made a mistake and the input field is hidden by some faulty CSS rule. With web test case, you cannot test that because the CSS rules are not even applied. They are not even passed, actually. What if your website is an e-commerce website and you load a bunch of external JavaScript from the advertising companies and tracking and analytics company, and there is one of the scripts that is faulty and that prevents the page to load at all? You cannot catch it because JavaScript is not executed at all by web test case because there is no JavaScript engine implementation in pure PHP, obviously, in this component. It's just HTML and very basic CSS selection. What if the browser itself, Chrome or Firefox, trigger a security feature to prevent a vulnerability in your website? For instance, if you have made a mistake and there is a cross-site scripting vulnerability in one of your forms, most modern browsers, by default, will detect it and will block the page or at least the form. If you have this kind of issue with WebKit, you cannot find it directly because you are not running a true Chrome or a real Firefox browser. So, all these kinds of issues you will never notice when using this kind of middle-level integration testing solution. And now, the website we have, the blog that we have generated, is a plain old blog using only HTML and some bits of CSS. But who isn't using at least one line of JavaScript in their modern website? Who in the room has still a website built in Symfony without any line of JavaScript? Nobody? It's the same for me. In most cases, you have at least Twig and some jQuery plugins everywhere in the application to enhance the form, to add an autocomplete field, to hide and to show something. Even very basic Symfony applications have that. If you are using Symfony 4, you will probably use Symfony encore, and you will probably have some pages or some components that will be entirely done using React or Vue or Angular. And you will not be able to test these components using web test case from Symfony. So it's a bit painful for modern web application development. If you trust in the modern web platform and you build a progressive web app, the progressive web app will be built entirely in JavaScript, HTML, in CSS using Vue, React, or Angular. And nothing will display on the screen at all if you haven't JavaScript enabled, because the app will first load, then it will fetch the data it needs through a remote API, for instance, using API platform, in JavaScript. So this kind of application cannot be tested at all with WebKit or crawled with Gut. So, if you have some lines of JavaScript, you cannot test that with the current test infrastructure of PHP and Symfony. And the main problem is that WebKit doesn't support JavaScript at all. So, if you do a web crawling script using Goot, or if you use web test case, you cannot reliably test modern web applications, even the one with just some lines of jQuery. So it's time to introduce Panther. Panther is basically BrowserKit, but instead of emulating a web browser, it runs a true web browser. So it will be able to execute Chrome or Firefox or Microsoft Edge on your own website. So it's not something new. There are a lot of other alternatives, especially in other languages. Actually, this has been inspired mainly by a tool called Nightwatch.js in JavaScript. And for instance, if you are creating a progressive web app, and if you want to test your progressive web app that will be fully in JavaScript, use the tool from the JavaScript ecosystem. Use Nightwatch. Don't use Panther for that. So it executes real web browsers. And so, because it executes real web browsers, it can execute CSS rules and JavaScript and everything that is actually supported by web browsers. But it exposes the exact same API than BrowserKit. And we will be that it's the main benefit of Panther. Internally, it uses the WebDriver protocol. So currently, it's a bit complicated because there are two different flavors of the WebDriver specification, a legacy one by Selenium, and a new one by the W3C. We use a low-level library designed by Facebook called PHP WebDriver, and we have done a lot of work of this library to make Panther working. So we try to contribute in the low-level brick what can be useful for all projects built on top of Facebook's PHP WebDriver. And we are currently contributing the support for the new flavor of the specification because it's the only flavor that is usable with Firefox. It's still not merged, but it will be merged in Facebook PHP WebDriver in the following weeks, I guess. So it's just BrowserKit with some extra methods because browsers have features that BrowserKit doesn't have. For instance, it is able to execute JavaScript. It is able to deal with asynchronous requests, AJAX or timeouts and things like that, so it may wait for elements, and it can take screenshots to see what is rendered exactly. And it's a library that is fully standalone. So today, I will focus on testing a Symfony application, but it's just a standalone PHP library, and you can use it to do some web crawling. You can also do it to test your own PHP application, even if they don't use Symfony at all, even if they use another framework. And the good thing is, not for you, I guess, but if you already know how BrowserKit or Web Test Case or Goot work, if you have already used these libraries, you already know how Panther works because it implements exactly the same API. So to convert a web test case to Panther, you just have to change the use statement, to change the class you extend, and to change this first line. Instead of create client, it's now create Panther client. And this exact same web testing scenario will now be executed to Google Chrome. And if there is some JavaScript or some CSS and anything that cannot be understood by BrowserKit but that can be interpreted by Chrome, it will be the case. So for a Symfony developer, it's super easy to use because there is nothing new. It's just the plain good old API, PHP public API of BrowserKit, but that will execute a web browser. To execute it, and here is the magic, you just have to run PHP unit. You can see that, of course, it takes more time because it executes a real browser. It executes all the JavaScript and all the CSS, so it's slower tests. But it's a drop-in replacement that just works for all your web test case tests, but also for your Goot script. Actually, it was why I started this project. I used to have a lot of web scraping scripts using Goot, and some of the websites I was monitoring were switching to JavaScript, they were switching to React. And so my large amount of good scripts were just not working anymore. But thanks to Panther, no, they can work because I can choose if I need to support JavaScript, it will be slow, but it will work, or if I can just pass the plain old HTML and so and can just use Gut and it will be fast. So when you extend Panther test case, you can choose if you want Panther, then you will execute a real web browser and you will have all the features, but it will be slow. Or if you just want Gut, then you still have HTTP support. It's convenient for testing single sign-on services, for instance. Your website depends on an external OAuth server, for instance, or SAML server. Then you can test it, but you don't need JavaScript. Then you can test it using just Gut. Or you can use the plain old web test case, because Panther test case, if you are in a Symfony context, it's a bit tricky, extends web test case. And this time, you have no HTTP support, no JavaScript support, no integrated web server. I will come back to that just after. But it's the fastest solution, obviously. So here are the extra features that comes with Panther. If your application is doing some request to an external API, JavaScript, by definition, is an asynchronous language. So you will have to wait the request to finish to assert on the HTML that will be generated asynchronously client-side. So there is a method for that, wait for, and you can just tell, do nothing while until this element isn't in the DOM tree of the page. There is another convenient feature, and it will be, there are some work in progress regarding this feature, because browsers can take screenshots, with Panther you can take a screenshot of the page. Okay? So we will add a new feature, in case of the test fail, we will save a screenshot somewhere, so you will be able to see what's going on, if there is an error that is displayed on the page or something like that. And then, another interesting one, is that you can execute JavaScript directly in the context of the page. When you do that, it's exactly as if you were testing your application using Chrome, using the Chrome developer console, and writing some JavaScript in the JavaScript execution context of the page. Another interesting thing that is working with Web Test Case 2, you can access the current Symfony container of the application, the current class, but not the same instance. So it means that because Panther will explain just after, but Panther will run in another process. If there are something that is not saved, something that is stateless, you will not be able to access it. But if you want to reuse a service that gives access to a stateful persistent layer, for instance, like Doctrine, or if you want to just use some code in your services to do some assertions, you can do it. For instance, there, I checked that the blog post has been inserted in the database. The main benefit for a PHP developer of Panther is that it's very, very easy to use. You have just to run the PHP unit command. There is nothing to install, nothing to configure. You don't need Selenium or anything like that. You don't need to configure your own web server. So how can it work if it requires a true web browser and it requires to have a proper HTTP server, but there is no web server to configure? You can add this environment variable, Panther no headless, and then you will see exactly what is happening. So you can see that Chrome is in automated mode. And I can see exactly what my tests are doing. And after that, I can just want to be, if I want to debug something, I can ask Panther to let the window open and do things I want to in the Chrome development tools, for instance. So by default, Panther comes with a tool from Google called Chrome Driver. It's a binary that we start a server. This server will find the local installation of Google Chrome in the standard places for Mac, for Windows, for Linux, and things like that. And it's this binary that will expose the WebDriver compatible API. So this tool is shipped with Panther. And using the process component of Symfony, when you will start your test, the web API from Google that will drive the the Chrome browser will be automatically started. Then it also, so by default, it will start Chrome in headless mode, so it will be a bit faster. But if you want to, you can see what Chrome is actually doing. Chrome is not mandatory. If you want to, very soon, you will be able to use the alternative from Firefox called JCoDriver. It works exactly the same thing, and we will ship JCoDriver too. It's not yet merged, but it's a pending pull request. If you want to use any Selenium server, you can do it. If you want to use the grid solution to test on a lot of different devices, you can do it. If you want to use remote testing services that can run your test on a lot of mobile phones, tablets, all the kind of web browsers and things like that, you can do it. You just have a configuration to set an environment variable to set, and you can use remote services like BrowserStack or Sauce Labs. By default, Panther will leverage the built-in PHP web server. So what it will do is finding the local PHP binary on your computer, then detecting the document root of your project. If it's a standard project, I think currently it supports Symfony and it maybe supports Laravel. I'm not sure about this one, but I think it works. And if your project is not standard, you can configure the where to find the public directory of your project. And it starts your application using the built-in web server in the test environment. And it even works on Windows. It was difficult, but that is. If you have your own testing setup with your own web server, if you use a local Nginx, if you use Docker, if you use Vagrant, you can change that and you can tell Panther to use your local web server. It's not mandatory to use the built-in one, but it allows the tool to work just like this. It supports by default, and it was not that easy because true web browser require X Windows server. And in continuous integration system, it's difficult to have a proper installation of X Windows server. There was some internal details that was difficult, but almost all continuous integration systems are supported out of the box. If you want to use Panther with Travis, you just have to add this line, add-ons, Chrome stable, and that's all, it works. Nothing more to do. If you want to use Panther with Docker, you just have to set this environment variable and installing the thing you need to, like Chromium, and it works. It's in the documentation, so you don't have to to find that by yourself. By default, Panther will start the integrated web server in the test environment of Symfony. So if you want to configure things with, for instance, if you want to use a specific database for Panther, it looks like a good idea. You can just set the database URL environment variable for the test environment using the PHP unit configuration file for now. This is not really convenient, and there is a pending pull request to improve the management of the environments with Symfony Flex. It's not only related to Flex, to Panther. It will help in many, many cases. The pull requests, actually, because there are several ones, are opened, and we are looking for feedback regarding these changes because it's, anyway. If you do some end-to-end test, you will have to have a proper database with data up to date and corresponding to what you test in your test scenarios. And with Symfony, managing databases for tests and managing fixtures is not easy since Symfony 4. It has really never been that easy. And since Symfony 4, it wasn't working at all. So now, since yesterday, it works. There is a new release of new package to manage fixtures and to help to do some database testing that has been just published, and now it's only since a few days. You can just type composer require Outlook Alice fixtures bundle, and in a few weeks, it will just be composer require Alice. and you get a bunch of libraries you need to do some database testing, to manage your fixtures in database, to purge your database, to generate fake data that will look like true ones, like first names or, I don't know, security social numbers or things like that. By default, it supports a lot of persistence layers, but the default one is Doctrinaire RM. To populate your database with pseudo-random data, you just have to use the Alice syntax, so you can specify the entity you want to populate with fake data, the number of elements you want in your database, and you can use the fakers from Françoise Aninotto. It's the same library that is used for years in Alice, and it's also used by Laravel and I think almost all framework out there. You can use the convenient generators like this one to populate some fake data, some random data. With this sample file and this command, here is how it looks when I load my tiny blog, the database I did populated with pseudo-random data. Pseudo-random because if I run two times this command, it's always the same data that will be generated. So I can assert on this and I can rely on this in my tests. And here is the new part. Before, to do some convenient integration tests and to do some convenient end-to-end tests, I have to know the state of my database. The content of my database should always be the same. So I must reset the state of my database before my test. And it was difficult to do with Symfony until a few days ago. Now we introduced a new set of features in Alice bundle, and you can just require this trait. It works exactly as in Laravel. There is no secrets. And if you use this trait in your case, in your test, then before every test case of the class, the database will be purged, and the fixtures that you have defined with Alice will be loaded. So the database, regardless of if the test is a success or a failure, will always be in the same state, and you will be able to assert on the data. There is another one that doesn't work with Panther called refresh database trait. This one is only for web test case, and it is faster because instead of purging the database at every test, it will wrap every test in a database transaction that will be rolled back at the end of the test. If you want to make your tests faster, there is a guy called Alex from France that has made a great job for improving the performance on Panther. And you can add this listener in your PHP unit configuration, and then the integrated PHP web server will be up during all the test suite. By default, it is started and killed at every test, so it's a bit slow. With this one, you improve the performance of the test already from a large factor. Just in time, perfect. So Panther is a brand new tool to assert to help you creating modern JavaScript web application with the Symfony framework. So the main idea behind Panther is to be able to, for when it's useful, to inject some React, some Vue.js script. There is already what you need to build it using Symfony encore. And now there is what you need to test it using Panther. It's also a tool that has been designed with web scraping in mind. So if you need to fetch to write script to fetch some data from random websites, you can also use Panther to do that. It was not the topic of the talk, but it's one of the main features of the library. If you like it, if you want to try it, it's already available online, and you can just go on. It's documented, but only in the GitHub repository for now. You will find nothing about Panther on the symfony.com website currently, but you go on this URL, and you will find all the code, all the documentation, and if you want to help fixing the last few bugs or missing features, you will be very welcome. Thank you very much.